Hello guys, so in yesterday's class, in the previous lecture, we talked about the definition of rigid bodies and then we argued that the number of degrees of freedom to specify the motion of rigid body is 6, and it's crucial to understanding the motion of rigid bodies how these 6 degrees of freedom are assigned appropriate generalized coordinates. Okay? And then we devised a scheme where you fix one point of the rigid body and then fix a coordinate system to the rigid body. So, as the rigid body moves in the space, the point where we are going to put the origin of the body fixed frame, that point moves. At the same time, the coordinate frame attached to the body also moves with the body. And basically, we are going to describe the motion of this coordinate system. Okay? So, if this coordinate system has 3 unit vectors I prime, j prime and k prime, then we will look at the transformation matrix between body fixed frame and the space fixed frame. And this transformation matrix, we argued, is orthogonal matrix and would require only 3 parameters. So, that is how we actually are going to use 6 generalized coordinates, 3 for the origin or a point on the rigid body and 3 for the orientation or 3 for the transformation matrix between the body fixed frame and the space frame. Okay, in today's lecture, I am going to argue that those transformation matrices basically are nothing but the rotation matrices, and then we will devise a scheme. Of course, rotation matrices can be specified in variety of different ways. We will find one suitable scheme, which is called as Euler angles, which we will use to describe the motion of the rigid bodies. And Euler angles is of course, one of the methods of doing it. There are many different schemes of assigning these generalized Euler angles, and so we will look at as we go along. All right. So, here is the scheme that we talked about. So, this is the rigid body, and with rigid body we have assigned, so this is the point O, and that is where we are going to put the body fix, origin of the body fix coordinate frame, and body fix coordinate frame is given by I prime and j prime there. And idea was to describe the motion of any point P of the rigid body, and we argued that r vector, which points to the point P, can be written as r, capital R vector, which basically is a vector pointing to the fixed point on the rigid body, and then a matrix A and UB. UB is basically coordinates of point P with respect to body fixed frame, and because it is body coordinates with respect to body fixed frame, these coordinates would never change, and the time dependence is entirely included in the transformation matrix A. Okay? Fine. Now, what we are going to do is in today's class, I am going to first argue that this transformation matrix A is basically simply a rotation. What I mean by that is, you look at this diagram here. So, the red coordinate system is the space fixed coordinate system, and the green one is attached to the body. So, whenever body rotates the or changes its orientation, this I prime, j prime and k prime also would change. And at any instant, whatever be the orientation of the rigid body, whatever be the position or location of this I prime, j prime and k prime vectors, that can be obtained from the space fixed coordinate system by just one single rotation about some axis. So, I have drawn this blue axis, just one single rotation about blue axis by certain angle, I should get this green one. It does not matter what that orientation is. Whatever that orientation is, you will always be able to find one axis and amount of rotation about that axis which will take I to I prime, J to J prime, and K to K prime. Okay. So that is the claim. Okay. Let's look at how we do this. The first method is called as angle axis representation. Here basically every rotation has an axis of rotation and an angle of rotation. Okay. So look at this figure here. I am going to use the axis of rotation, which is a vector. So this long red vector that you see is basically a cap vector, which is axis of rotation. And I will describe this axis of rotation by a unit vector a cap, where a cap has three components a1, a2, a3. Okay, and of course, it is a unit vector. So, a1, a2, a3, all three are not independent of each other, because a1 square plus a2 square plus a3 square must be equal to 1. So, basically there are only two parameters in the specification of axis, and the third parameter is the angle of rotation theta. Okay. So, that is the angle of rotation. Now, what I want to do is this. Look at this figure here. In this figure, so this long red axis is the axis of rotation. Take this r vector. Okay. R vector is shown here, which is basically OB vector. And now, if you rotate this vector, basically you are rotating everything around this axis a cap. So, when you rotate everything, this r vector also will rotate by angle theta and go to this r prime. Basically, r vector will in fact just trace out a cone of angle alpha there. Okay. So, that is the initial angle, and because of rotation, the angle between the two will not change. So, r vector will simply trace out a surface of a cone if you do a complete 2 pi rotation. And the tip of the vector will actually trace out this circle. Okay. This is simple. So, if I rotate it by amount theta, it would go to this new r prime vector. And what I want to do is write this r prime vector as a transformation of r vector. So, that is basically the transformation matrix connected with or associated with this particular rotation. Now, this angle here alpha is fixed. So, that is the angle of the cone. Now, what I will do is, if I look at the same diagram from the top, from the direction of the axis, then I will see this top circle there. Okay, so, I have drawn this top circle here separately, and in this top circle, basically your axis of rotation now comes out of the board and is perpendicular to the board. Okay, that is shown by this a cap here. Point B is where the r vector's tip is there, and after rotation by amount theta, this point B goes to point C there. Okay. Right. So, the angle, now it is a planar diagram. So, in the angle here between AB and AC is of course theta, that is the amount of rotation. And what I am going to do is, I am going to drop a perpendicular from C to AB. Remember, AB, C are a planar points now. So, I drop a perpendicular and call that point as point D. Okay. Fine. So, the geometry of the figure is clear to us. Okay. All the points that we have marked there, they are clear. Now, let us start. The r prime vector here is basically nothing but OA vector plus AC vector. Okay. And this AC vector, I am also going to write it as AD vector plus DC vector. So, basically r prime is nothing but sum of these three vectors, OA plus AD plus AC vector. And then we will look at each one of these three vectors there. Okay. The first, let me look at OA. OA vector, basically this is the OA vector. OA vector is parallel to A cap. So, its direction must be A cap. All we need to do is figure out its magnitude. what is the magnitude of this? Magnitude of this vector OA will be equal to the angle between R and A cap direction is alpha. So, this will be R cos alpha times A cap, or we can also write it as R vector dot product with A cap vector, that will basically give you R cos alpha modulus of A is 1 and then A cap vector. So, this is your O A vector. The next one, I will define this n cap vector. Look at this diagram here. So, now if you look at the top diagram, point O, B and A, they are in one plane, okay? And if I take R cross A cap or A cap cross R, I will get a vector which is perpendicular to this O A B plane. And if I look at it from the top here, so basically point O is right below point A here in this diagram. So, the n cap vector is perpendicular to that, and I will take A cross R. So, n cap vector basically is perpendicular to A B direction, fine. What is the magnitude of A cross R? That is basically nothing but modulus of A, that is 1, then R, that is the length of this vector R, and sine of angle between the two, so that would be sine alpha. So, n cap is a unit vector, this has a magnitude of R sine alpha, so I divide A cap cross R by R sine alpha to get the n cap vector. Okay. Now, we have got this n cap vector there. Now, let me look at this DC vector. DC vector, you can immediately see, is parallel to n cap vector, because n cap is perpendicular to AB, so is CD. CD is also perpendicular to AB. So, basically what will happen is here, DC vector, this is this DC vector. DC vector has a direction which is n cap, okay, and its magnitude of this one is length of AC multiplied by sin theta. So, that is length of AC multiplied by sin theta. What is length of AC? Length of AC, go back to this diagram, length of AC is nothing but R sin alpha. Okay, so, I will write this. So, this is basically n cap, the magnitude of this is R sin alpha and into sin theta. And now, we can immediately see n times R times sin alpha, n cap times R times sin alpha is nothing but A cap cross R, okay? And then you multiply it by this sin theta there. So, I have got my DC vector too. And finally, I want to look at the AD vector. So, AD vector, go back to this diagram again. Your A cap points out of the board, okay? So, if I take, for example, here A cross n cap cross A. So, this is n cap cross A, use your right hand rule, that is basically pointing towards A D. Okay? So, it is parallel to A D vector. So, A D vector is basically A cross n cap or A cap, basically it is a n cap cross A cap, but I will interchange the order and put a minus sign there. And what is the magnitude of A D? Magnitude of AD is nothing but magnitude of AC into cos theta. Okay? All right. Magnitude of AC we already know. Magnitude of AC is nothing but R sin alpha. Okay? And then I will put everything together. R sin alpha into n cap. R sin alpha into n cap. That is nothing but A cross R. Put that there. So, basically what you get is minus A cap cross A cap cross R times cos theta. So, there you are, the complete R prime, which is O A. So, we have O A vector here, then we have A D vector here, and we have D C vector there. Okay? So, this is basically the formula for the R prime in terms of R and the parameters of rotation. what we did was, in between I had introduced angle alpha and the unit vector n cap, but I do not want my answer in terms of alpha or n cap or any other quantity. I want it only, so the r prime is result of rotation. Rotation should be specified by just three parameters, which is a cap and theta. Remember, a cap has two parameters. So, look at this expression. This expression involves only a vector, a cap vector and theta, okay, in the form of sin theta and cos theta, and the original vector r. That is it. Now, I can rearrange this a little. If I use a back cap rule on this one here, then you can immediately see this one is, according to back cap rule, would be this minus r vector. Basically, it is a minus r vector into a cap dot a cap, but a cap dot a cap is 1. So, you get this. Put this back into this formula. If I put this back into this formula, I will get 1 positive plus 1 and there is a r vector. So, that is how I get my final form of the rotation formula. Every vector r turns to r prime vector under this rotation, and that r prime vector can be calculated as r vector plus a cap cross r into 1 minus cos theta and plus a cap cross r into sin theta. Okay? And this is famously known as Rodrigues formula. Yeah? Right. So, basically what I have got is how to calculate r prime vector given axis and angle of rotation. Okay? And of course, r is given. So, how r turns into r prime. But this is not what we want. We actually want a matrix representation of this. In a sense, I want to write r vector as a column matrix as x, y, z. R prime will be x prime, y prime, z prime. And I want the 3 by 3 matrix which changes x, y, z into x prime, y prime, z prime. And look at this formula. I will convert this formula into matrix form in a moment. Okay? Right. So, here is the Rodrigues formula. Now, you look at what happens to the cross product. So, a cap cross r, first of all, I am going to put r vector in a column form as x, y, z. Okay? So, that is the r vector. Now, once I have r vector, let me take a cross product of r, a cap with r, and use the standard in Cartesian components or Cartesian coordinate systems. I know how to do this. This is basically y component of A multiplied by z component of R minus the z component of A into y component of R. Basically, you write this. Now, I have this and I can now write this column matrix as a 3 by 3 matrix into x, y, z, because if you look at these components here, they are basically linear in x, y, z. Okay. If they are linear in x, y, z, I can always write it as 3 by 3 matrix into x, y, z. So, you do that and just by inspection you can immediately see that the first row here will be exactly equal to minus a 3 x will be exactly equal to minus a 3 y plus a 2 z. That is what we have here. Okay. So, what has happened here in this process? The parameters of rotation are in this 3 by 3 matrix, r vector is in this column matrix. So, the two things have separated neatly. Okay? Fine. So, if I have this as S A, I will call this matrix as S A. And you can see that this matrix has diagonal entries which are 0, and off diagonal entries, they are basically it forms an anti-symmetric matrix. So, when you take a transpose of this matrix, you will get minus of S A. Fine. Now, what will happen to A cross R? Basically, A cross R, think of it as another column matrix. When you take a cross product with A, you basically multiply from the left by S A. So, whatever this entity is, you multiply it by another SA matrix from the left, but this one already is SA times R. So, basically A cross R is nothing but SA square times R, okay, and it is a matrix multiplication, remember. So, it is associative in the sense I can just take basically this would be SA into R, but because matrix product is associative, I can immediately club this SA square together and calculate this and then multiply it to R, okay. So, that is fine. Now, you go back to this formula. Now, I can convert this into a matrix form. So, now here this A cross R will become SA times R in the matrix form. This one here will become SA square times R. What about this one here, this R? That is nothing but identity matrix times R. Okay, this is basically will give you R again, and on the left hand side you have R prime, whose coordinates basically would be x prime, y prime and z prime. So, if I write that in terms of column matrices, I would get R prime, which is equal to identity matrix plus 1 minus cos theta times SA square plus SA into sin theta. So, this basically inside the square bracket you have 3 by 3 matrix, and outside there is a column matrix, on this side you have column matrix. So, basically we have found a way of finding new coordinates in terms of the old coordinates for the rotation transformation, and this rotation transformation here is basically the transformation matrix that we are looking for. Okay. So, I will write that as now R matrix as R a cap theta, which is equal to I plus. So, this is basically just 3 by 3 matrix separated from that equation there. I am going to do little more from this matrix. I will come back to this matrix in a moment, and there are several things associated with it which we will not right away talk about in this lecture, but one thing, one property that I would like to talk about before moving on. So, I will define these three matrices as J 1, J 2, J 3. Look at the matrix entries of J 1. In J 1, basically first row and first column are all 0. This is first row and first column are 0, and the remaining 2 by 2 matrix has off diagonal entries and it is anti-symmetric, and this is basically minus 1 plus 1. If you compare it with your SA, look at basically there was a A 1 component here. I have taken that A 1 component out, and what remains is minus 1 1. Similarly, you define J 2, that would be plus 1 here, minus 1 here. So, that is J 2, and then there is a J 3. So, I can write this SA matrix as a linear combination of these three matrices. And so, your SA matrix would become A 1 J 1 plus A 2 J 2 plus A 3 J 3, and this is your A 2. And there is a, you know, so basically if you look at all possible SA matrices for rotation for whatever A cap B, that is anti-symmetric and it is traceless there. Okay. Now, because of that, J 1, J 2, J 3 basically are basis of the set of all anti-symmetric 3 by 3 matrices. Okay. Every anti-symmetric matrix can be written in terms of J 1, J 2, J 3. So, they are basically called as generators of the rotation there, and they have a very beautiful property. If you calculate the commutator, if you know what commutator is, it is basically, now they are matrices, matrix multiplication is not commutative. Okay. So, commutator is defined as, so commutator of two matrices A and B would be A B minus B A. I am sure all of you, most of you have come across the commutators. So, you, if you take a commutator of J 1 and J 2, what you get is J 3. If you take a commutator of J2 and J3, we get J1 and the other, the third cyclic permutation of this. And many of you would actually remember this or have already come across in say quantum mechanics, where the angular momentum operators also have exactly same kind of commutator relationship. And it is not surprising, the root of that angular momentum operator in quantum mechanics in fact lies in these three matrices here. Okay. There is a mathematical theory that connects the rotations with angular momentum. So, that is straightforward. Okay. But some of you may not have come across it, but this is basically what it is. That is why I wanted to mention this property here, that the generators of rotation and angular momentum, even in classical mechanics, they are related. Okay. And that we will see later in the transformation. Basically, we saw it in the when we discussed the variational principle, but we will do that again when we will be talking about the canonical transformations. Okay. Let me take one example. If I want to construct a rotation about z axis, so your a cap must be z, basically it is 0, 0, 1 now, and the amount of rotation let us say is theta. Let me calculate S A matrix and the S A square. S A matrix will be nothing but J 3. So, A 1 A 2 are 0. So, A 1 J 1 is 0, A 2 J 2 is 0, it is basically A 3 J 3, but A 3 is anyway 1. So, your S A is nothing but J 3, okay, and J 3 is this matrix. Take a square of that, that will give you this minus 1 minus 1 and 0 on the diagonal. And now, you use the formula. So, if we use the formula, R rotation matrix about z cap by angle theta will be equal to identity plus 1 minus cos theta into S A square plus sin theta into S A. And take this, basically what will happen is on this element, you have 1 from here, there is a minus 1 from here that will cancel with each other, and there is a plus cos theta in 1-1 place. Similarly, for the second 2-2 place also has cos theta, 3-3 place has just 1, and the remaining 2 off diagonal entries are coming from here. So, the final answer would come out to be cos theta minus sin theta into cos theta, and of course, 3-3 component will be plus 1. This is the familiar rotation we always have learned even from the 12th standard. Rotation about z axis rotates the coordinate system or rotates the vectors using this matrix. What about the inverse? If I give you orthogonal matrix, can we extract from there the angle and axis of rotation? So, this is the crucial part. You know, in the beginning I made a claim that all those transformation orthogonal transformations were actually rotations. So, the reverse also can be done. We can easily see this, that I am going to ask you people to do this calculation. Take a sum of 3 diagonal elements of R, that will actually come to 1 plus 2 cos theta, and that is basically trace of A. So, the angle of rotation can be calculated from A by just taking trace of A minus 1 and divide by 2, and then you take a cos inverse of that, that will give you angle of rotation. How do I get the axis parameters? And if you remember the SA matrix, so what I am going to do here is I will take A 2 1 minus A 1 2, but remember A 2 1 minus A 1 2 is result of identity plus 1 minus cos theta into S A square, and then you have S A, but S A square is symmetric matrix. So, when I take a when I take a difference of two off diagonal elements a21 and a12, the component which is coming from S square or contribution coming from S square will cancel. The only contribution is from the sin theta term, sin theta times S A. But what is there on a21 and a12? That is basically a3. So, your a3 is nothing but a21 minus a12 divided by 2 times sin theta. And what about a2 and a1? Oh, similarly, you can do a cyclic permutation of these indices and you would get a2. So, basically a2 would be equal to a13 minus a31 divided by 2 sin theta. And this formula of course will not work if sin theta is 0. That is basically when you have rotation by amount pi and rotation by amount 0. Okay? But amount 0 is only identity and rotation by pi is easily traceable. So, as long as cos theta is not equal to plus 1 or minus 1, this formula will work. Okay? Fine. Let me take one example. Look at this matrix here. In this matrix, I want to calculate the angle and axis. So, calculate the trace of this. Trace basically is sum of the diagonal elements. Sum of the diagonal elements is 0. So, trace is 0. So, cos theta must be equal to minus half and this gives you theta is equal to 2 pi by 3. And similarly, you calculate a3. a3 is basically a21 is 1, then a12 is 0 divided by 2 times sin of 2 pi by 3. Now, that would be square root 3 by 2 and this gives me 1 by root 3. Similarly, calculate a2 and a1, that also gives you 1 by root 3. So, basically this A matrix, is this matrix orthogonal? Remember, we learnt in the last lecture how to check whether A matrix is orthogonal or not. All you have to do is take a dot product of 3 rows. Okay? Look at the dot product of first row with itself, that gives you 1, dot product of first row with the second, that gives you 0, and dot product of first row with the third row also will give you 0. So, this is the orthogonal matrix which basically represents a rotation about 1-1-1 axis and by what amount? By 2 pi by 3, 120 degrees basically. Okay. So, this is basically how we can specify 3 parameters of that transformation matrix which is required in our rigid body motion. It is basically a rotation and the axis will have 2 parameters, angle is the third parameter. So, 3 parameters together will give you that transformation. But it may not always be best way of again representing. Again, I will re-emphasize that you would use the generalized coordinates only if they are useful to you. Okay? So, here is one useful way of denoting the same A matrix, but using some different parameters called as Euler angles. Look at this diagram here. So, here I have 3 axes. So, first look at the 3 arrows, the red arrow, the green arrow and the blue arrow. That is basically your I cap, J cap and K cap, that is fixed in the space. And when you have a body fixed coordinate system, which is I prime, J prime and K prime. So, I now have 3 more axes here, whose arrowhead is represented by a sphere or it is a knob. So, red one is I prime, then green one is J prime and of course, the blue one is K prime. So, I have the space fixed coordinate system, which is indicated by red, green and blue arrows, and I prime, J prime and K prime, which is body fixed coordinate system given by red, green, blue what I call as knobbed arrows. So, there are knobs instead of arrowheads there, okay. But the same color scheme, the first vector I or I prime, they both have red color, then J and J prime have green color, and K and K prime have the blue color. And we define this Euler angles as it is seen in this, you know, frame. So, in fact, you know, before I explain that diagram there, I will say that you can achieve any rotation which takes your I j k to I prime j prime k prime by 3 steps. Okay. Now, the first step would be, okay, I will come to the only first step is you rotate about z axis. So, initially think of it like this, you have I j k and your I prime j prime k prime are coincident with I j k, okay, they are same as I j k. I want to go to this body fix frame. First thing I will do is I will rotate about z axis by angle phi. If I rotate about z axis by angle phi, my red arrow will come to, so this is angle phi, it will come to this black line here, and this black line is what I call as nodal line. Okay. Now, corresponding to this, the y axis or j unit vector will also rotate, but these two vectors, they will remain in x y plane. The second rotation that you do is basically rotation about nu x axis by amount theta. So, what will happen? Your nu x axis right now is at the black line, you rotate the coordinate system about the black line. So, now nu x axis remains wherever it is, the k unit vector will tilt and go to this nu vector there. This angle basically is the angle theta. And finally, now your nu z axis, you make another rotation about nu z axis by angle psi. And these three angles, they are called as Euler angles there. So, what we are essentially doing is this. I have start with I j k, when I do the first rotation, I goes to n cap, okay. I will call this black line as nodal line and use a symbol n cap for it. So, I goes to n cap, j goes to some xi prime, which we cannot see in this diagram right now, but it is hidden behind that plane there, and k remains k. This is the first rotation, this is about step 1. In the step 2, rotation is about n cap, so n cap remains as it is, and you have a, you know, both these xi prime will go to some xi double prime, which also we do not know where it is right now from this diagram, but k goes to k prime, okay, that is the final one. And now, the third rotation is about nu z axis, that is nu k prime. So, k prime remains as it is, xi prime becomes j prime and n cap becomes I prime. Okay. This is the idea, this is how we will do the 3 steps. And that nodal line, basically you can see, the moment you see this diagram, this plane contains I prime and the green knobbed vector is j prime, I prime j prime is in this tilted plane, and x y are in this horizontal plane. The intersection of these two planes is basically your nodal line. Now, I can define the Euler angles very easily. Euler angles would be the angle between nodal line and I cap is basically your phi vector. The angle between nodal line and I cap vector is your angle phi. angle between nodal line and I prime is your angle psi. And finally, angle between k and k prime is theta. So, if I give you I j k, I prime, j prime, k prime, can I identify these three angles? They are very easy. Once you have k and k prime, take a cross product of k and k prime, you in fact will get the nodal line. Once you get the nodal line, you calculate the angle between nodal line and I, that is your phi, and angle between nodal line and I prime would give you psi. But look at these three steps, what do they do? They basically transform coordinates or give you new vectors as you rotate, and this is basically three successive steps. So, the coordinates in body fixed frame would be obtained from the coordinates of the space fixed frame. So, R s can be calculated, R b can be calculated from R s by first transforming the coordinates R s to this intermediate. So, you start from here. For in the first step, you get coordinates with respect to this coordinate system. That is basically product of these two. Now, in the second step, you are going from this coordinate system to this coordinate system. Okay? The coordinates of R with respect to this coordinate system is already this product multiplied by another rotation matrix about x, that gives you the coordinates of R vector with respect to this third coordinate system, and the final coordinate system is the coordinate system that we want, okay, which is I prime, j prime, k prime, that you obtain by multiplying by z psi. And remember, while doing the calculation in the first few slides, we did not want the transformation between R s and R b, but we wanted transformation, we wanted transformation from R b to R s. So, all that I will do, each one of this is orthogonal matrix, its inverses are only transpose. So, take a inverse of this entire matrix, that would be R transpose, basically this matrix will come here with a transpose, and similarly the remaining two. This is the A matrix that we want, okay? This is the A matrix that we want for our calculation. So, this is about the Euler angles, and while doing this, you know, matching, I did not pay attention to y. J unit vector. So, basically here it was very simple. I first move to nodal line, then make sure that k goes into k prime, and the second third rotation about z is made in such a way that this nodal line goes into I prime. So, basically I goes to I prime is ensured, k goes to k prime is ensured. We did not worry about j going into j prime, but that you do not require, because the moment I prime and j prime are correctly identified, j prime is nothing but k prime cross I prime. So, all you needed to do was just to make sure that your k goes to k prime, I goes to I prime. If that happens, j automatically goes to the required j prime. Okay. So, this is how you calculate the A matrix, and in fact, this is one of the most useful ways of describing the rigid body motion, which we will use later in the calculations, when we will talk about the dynamics of the systems of the rigid bodies. And of course, this is not the only way in which Euler angles can be defined. There are many different systems of defining three angles, and there is a large class which is called as generalized Euler angles. So, you can use not only, you know, so I had three steps here, and there is a peculiar arrangement there, there is a z cap, x cap, z cap. How about x cap, y cap, z cap? Can I do three successive rotations about x, y and z and still get, you know, correct transformation matrix? Yes, that is also possible. There are several systems that are in use. For example, aviation industry, for example, uses three angles. So if you have an aeroplane, then aeroplane has a direction in which it is moving, that's basically heading. Then there is a, so heading could be anywhere along, like, you know, a rotation about z axis. Then there is a pitch, that's basically going upwards or going downwards, that's another angle. And third one is called as a roll. So basically, leaving this axis as it is, the aeroplane can tilt either ways along its wings, that's called as a roll. So there are several other ways of, you know, defining these generalized Euler angles. This is one of them which we use in physics very often, but the mechanical engineers probably would be using different systems depending on the application there. Okay, so here is the summary of what I said, that the three angles are basically angles between theta is angle between k and k prime, phi is angle between I and n cap, and psi is angle between I prime and n cap. And let me take one example here. I just give you one matrix, okay, and ask you to calculate the three Euler angles from here. Now, once I give you this matrix, I can always calculate angle and axis. Remember, in the first part, we figured out how to calculate angle and axis. Okay. In the second part, this matrix can be written as product of three matrices, each corresponding to one Euler angle, and we want to find the Euler angles there. Now, if you look at this A matrix, where is the, first of all, is it orthogonal? Yes, we can quickly check this. If I take dot product of this with itself, I will get 3 plus 1 plus 4, that is 8, divided by 8, so that will give me 1. How about dot product of this and this? This will give me minus 3, minus 1, that is minus 4, and that is plus 4, so that will give you 0. And finally, here, this product of these two will be equal to plus root 6, and this will be minus root 6. So, basically, we have checked few of these rows are orthogonal to each other. You can check all the remaining rows pairwise are orthogonal to each other. Fine. So, this is a rotation matrix. Now, if you look at this one, where is my I prime? I prime basically is in the first row. J prime is in the second row, K prime is in the third row. That you can do very simply by putting I vector here. If I put I vector here, I would have 1 0 0 multiplied by this A matrix from the left will give me I prime. So, your I prime vector is basically in the first row here, J prime is in the second row here, and K prime is in the third row. This is not same as, you know, the A matrix that we are using, where we put I prime, J prime, K prime in the columns. This, in fact, I should choose a different symbol, but that is okay. So, here I prime, J prime, K prime are in the rows. So, first thing we will do is calculate the nodal line. Nodal line is K cross K prime divided by the magnitude of K cross K prime. Now, K prime is here, square root 2 minus square root 2, square root 6 and 0. So, this is basically square root 2 I minus square root 2 I plus square root 6 j cross k. I know how to do this cross product. That gives me minus square root 6 I cap minus square root 2 j divided by 2 root 2. Okay. Fine. Now, find the angle between this and your I prime. Where is I prime? This is my I prime. Calculate this. So, cos phi, sorry, the first thing is calculate the angle between I and n cap, that will be your angle phi, that gives me phi is equal to pi by 3. Similarly, cos psi will be n cap dot product with I prime, this I prime will come from the first row there. And once you take this first row, you can put that, take this dot product and calculate psi, that comes to pi by 4. And finally, the third angle would be angle between k and k prime, and that is simple. Your k prime is here, its k component is 0, so its dot product will be 0. And because its dot product is 0, you get theta is equal to pi by 2. So, here now we have complete machinery. Whenever we want to describe the motion of a rigid body, I need the location of one point on the rigid body. Typically, we will choose it as a center of mass, not necessarily, but typically choose it as center of mass. And then the orientation of the body is described by three generalized parameters. I can choose those three parameters in many different ways. I have given you two different ways of doing it. One is you specify the axis and angle of a rotation which takes I j k to I prime j prime k prime, or you specify these three Euler angles which are the angles described this way, but basically they uniquely take I j k into I prime j prime k prime. So, this is the central idea of using generalized coordinates or Euler angles as generalized coordinates for the motion of rigid bodies. So, in tomorrow's class, we will develop some more machinery before going to the actual dynamics of rigid bodies, that means under torques, how the system would actually move.